Chapter 2, Philippians chapter 2. So we hear sometimes of works salvation. So that is just to go ahead and make sure you understand. Work salvation is not salvation. You cannot work for your salvation. Well, we're going to talk about the topic of work it out. Work it out is what we're going to talk about. We're going to start Philippians chapter 2, verses 12. And 13, and some of you may be wondering, I thought we were going to do the Lord's Supper today. We just kind of discussed it among a few of us and thought it'd be best to postpone that for a couple of weeks, let things settle down a little bit. So that is why we chose not to do that today. But we're going to talk about work it out. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. See what the scripture says about the word work. It says, "Wherefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only." So here Paul has been with the people of Philippi. He's been with the church of Philippi, building them up, lifting them up, encouraging them, guiding them in the way they should go. And now he is going to have to depart. He's going to have to depart. And see, the Lord is speaking to the people of Philippi through Paul here. So it is just as relevant, just as applicable to us today. So keep that in mind. He says, "Having always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure." To do of his good pleasure. So there, you know, we were talking about this morning in our Bible study class that there is so much more influence on the world. There is much greater influence on the world outside of the church. So I get up here and I can preach, and man, I can just base y'all down with scriptures, tell you what you ought to do, tell you what you ought not to do. But the influence that you have on others is much, much greater than any sermon I'll ever preach. Now, it may impact an individual, and I hope it does. It may convict an individual, and I hope it does. But the impact on the world, the impact in general, the larger impact is from you, from us as we go outside of the walls of this church. So he says, work out your own salvation. So is he saying work for your salvation? No. He is saying live it out. We work, we grow, we mature as we go about, or we should. We should. So just want to read a few notes. It says, God has not left us alone in our struggles to do his will. He wants to come alongside us and work and within us to help us. He helps us want to obey him and then gives us the power to do it. He doesn't just say, go do it. He says, I'm going to help you. The secret test changed lives here. And we should be submitting to God and his will to be like Christ. We must condition ourselves to think like Christ, to change our desires to be more like Christ. We need the power of the indwelling spirit, the influence of faithful Christians, the obedience to God's word, and sacrificial service. Often it is in doing God's will that we get the desire to do God's will. The more you do something, the better you get at it, the stronger you get at it, the more confident you grow in it. That goes with anything. So the less you put into your spiritual life, the less you're going to get out of it. The less you put in to your spiritual growth, the more immature you're going to be as a Christian. You know, and it breaks my heart to see people come to church, come to church, come to church. And I'm all about coming to church. If you've been around very long, you know that. But if that's all you have for your spiritual life, you can come to church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night, every special occasion, participate in every religious practice, and die and go to hell without a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I mean, I can put you in that baptistry till your toes shrivel up and look like little raisins. You'll go to hell with raisin toes without a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Think about that. So now let's back up a little bit. Look at Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. So God is talking here through Paul in Philippi what it means to work out your own salvation. We need to grow. We need to mature. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6 says, "Be confident Be confident of this very thing. He's trying to encourage the believers at Philippi here. Be confident of this very thing. If you are truly saved, now keep that in mind. The Bible says, the Lord says through Paul that He, God, which has begun a good work in you, will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. See, we are working out. We are growing. We are maturing. But are you? You know, when you got saved, you got saved at a later date, or maybe you got saved at a younger date. You didn't start living it. Then you got married and had a home. Hopefully, as you've grown and you've matured, the things that go on in your home, the things that go on in your life, the things that come out of your mouth, hopefully will be more and more edifying to God and not self. If you look at your life and you walk through, you know, I challenge every one of you to do a spiritual inventory of what's going on when I've been here. And then I encourage you, I challenge you to go home and do a physical inventory of things that are in your home, things that are hanging on your wall, things that are in your cabinets, things that come on your TV. Are they honoring God? Are they glorifying God? Or are they bringing shame to God? Think about that. So the God who begins His work in us continues it throughout our lives and will finish it when we meet Jesus face to face. Face to face. So God's work for us, began when Christ died on the cross to forgive our sins. And His work in us begins when the Holy Spirit comes in. Of course, that is at salvation. Paul is describing the process of Christian growth and maturity that begins when we accept Jesus and continues until Christ returns. So if you're saved, then Christ has worked His life into you. See, you can't work your way to Christ. See, Christ did work. All of your work is worthless when it comes to salvation. Jesus did the work. We just have to accept it. So if it's not salvation, it's not a question of whether, you know, we're truly saved or not. If you've called upon Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you are. The work's already been done. He is in you. The Lord is in the person of the Holy Spirit. And that's a fact. In the process of growing, God wants to work Himself into all areas of your life. Every area. Your work thought, your personal thought, your intimacy thoughts, your actions. He wants to work into every area, every aspect of your life, all of them. Even how we react and around the circumstances that happen to us. He is in you, encouraging you that He and your faith may grow together. That they may grow together. And He's saying, let me start doing life through you. Let me help you make the right choices. We talked about it in Bible study this morning. If you are not in a right place with God, you're never going to successfully live right for God. You're always going to struggle. You're never going to have peace. I've said it, and I believe it with all my heart. The most miserable person in the world is not a lost person, but a saved person that is not living for God. A person that claims to be a Christian, yet they put everything else ahead of God. That is a miserable human being, because you are going to struggle. You are going to struggle. And spiritual struggle begins to build into physical struggle. And then it begins to become weight. And the Scriptures talk about where we should put our weight, where we should put our burdens. So God is saying, let me start doing life through you and help you make decisions. And time and time and time again, you know, I talk to people, I talk to young couples particularly, and I say, you know, man, I'd love to see you get involved, especially you men out there. God has called you. Am I calling you out? I am. I ought to make you stand up. God has called you out to be the spiritual leader in your home. If you are not, I hope and I pray that you leave here convicted. That doggone preacher. Amen. I hope you do. I hope you feel bad. And I had a friend of mine here a while back. He's not real religious, you know, if you want to say that. He said, man, I went to this funeral. He said, man, me and my son left there feeling horrible. I was ready to get out of there. Because it was a sermon at the funeral. And the man's wife said, man, that was the best. I love to hear preaching like that. And it's the difference between somebody that is hungry for the word and somebody that don't want the conviction of the word. See, a lot of people leave here mad because the preacher preaches on their business, you know? Maybe God preaching on your business. Maybe you ought to take care of your business. Maybe you ought to tend to your flock at home. But see, God said, and it's my ministry. You are not my first ministry. You're a great ministry in my life, but my number one ministry is my wife and my kids. And then out from there, maybe my parents, maybe my aunts and uncles. That should be our priority. So a couple of questions for you to ask yourself, am I giving? And we talked about this, we've been studying through the book of Isaiah on Sunday mornings, and those of you, you know, kind of youngish adults, you ought to be in Bible study class. You ought to be. I guess I could get most everybody to stand up there, right? Sunday mornings, we have Bible study class. If you ain't coming, you're missing out on a spiritual blessing. You're missing out on a spiritual opportunity to grow. But I hear people all the time say, well, but I just fill in the blank. I just can't get up. You go to work at 7 o'clock in the morning, 5 days a week. You can't make it to 9:45, breakfast included. Sunday morning Bible study. Free breakfast. Ain't going to charge you a bit. But I promise you a blessing if you'll give God the opportunity. But you're robbing yourself of a blessing. They say, well, but that's my only day off. Hey, you know what? I don't get Sundays off. Think about that. What about the preacher? Think about that. Well, it's my only day off. Say, well, but I'm tired. You can sit right, we got cushion pews. You can sit right here every Sunday and be comfortable. We got rid of them old hardwood benches. You know, some of the old times said, boy, I remember them old hardwood benches. And they preached a lot longer than 20 minutes back then days. Think about that. Well, but I fill in the blank. Are you giving to be blessed? Or do you recognize that you are blessed, so you're giving? Are you working? Are you serving to be loved? Or do you realize you are loved, so you're working and you're serving? Because you're loved. See, you can't work for your salvation. You work because of your salvation. I mean, Jesus Christ literally was beaten. The Bible says, unrecognized. All these movies show him, and you can still look kind of like the same guy with a little bit of blood. That is not the way it was. Read the scriptures, study the Word of God, and you will see that he was beaten beyond the legal limits of the law. For your sin. For your sin. If you would just accept that personal relationship, and part of a personal relationship is saying to God, I'm going to grow in you. I'm going to grow in you. If you ain't willing to agree to grow in God, I don't think you agree to accept Him as your personal Savior. I really don't. I really don't. I really think there's an issue with that. And it's not my issue, it's God's. So look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8 and 9. Catch up with you here. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 8 and 9 says, who shall? Again, now Paul is talking to the people of Corinth. The Lord is working through Paul here, just as he is working through and in us. He says, who shall confirm you unto the end? Talking about the Lord. That you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. And you say, well, man, I'm just not worth it. You're not without Jesus Christ. But Jesus. I just can't do enough. You can't. But Jesus. The but changes everything. It changes everything. He says, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of His Son Jesus Christ, our Lord. If there is no relationship, there cannot be true fellowship. Not according to the Word of God. Let's go forward just a little bit and look at Thessalonians chapter 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1 through 3. Living in the light of Christ's return. Finally, brethren, pray for us. Pray for us that the word of the Lord may have free course and be glorified even as it is with you. I pray that the Lord will have free course in your life, and that we may be delivered from unreasonable and wicked men. For all men, not all of them, have not faith. But the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. Beneath the surface of the routine and daily life, a fierce struggle among invisible spiritual powers is being waged. It is real. Our main defense is prayer, that God will protect us from evil and that He will make us strong. The following guidelines can help you prepare and survive these attacks. Take the threat of spiritual attacks seriously. It's real, folks. It is real. Take the threat serious. Pray for the strength and help from God. Pray for strength and help from God. Study the Bible to recognize Satan's style and tactics. Memorize Scripture so it will be a source of help. No matter where you are, associate with those who speak truth. Practice what you were taught by your spiritual leaders. So, I don't know who watches football anymore. I watch a little college football. Tigers won last night. Alabama won last night. That's okay, though. I'm happy for them. You know what they do before they go up against an opponent? They study. They study. They set up a mock team that plays the opponent so they can learn the opponent. So they can learn their ways. So they can learn their tricks. They watch hours and hours and hours and hours of film. They study. And we think we can get through life showing up at church once in a while, listening to a little bit of a sermon, and think we're good to go to battle the greatest battle we'll ever face. And that is a spiritual battle. Think about that, folks. I mean, we're raising our kids to be the best, to be their best at everything in the world. But what about our spiritual training? What about that? What about our spiritual training? We need to work it out in our life. We need to work it out in the lives of our children. If you were to place, think about this, a real apple beside a fake one, think you'd be able to tell the difference? Wouldn't take long. They gather dust. They look different. Something's different about them. You'd be able to tell it. God sees this kind of difference when you try to work your way to Him versus allowing Him to work His way out of you, to live through you. God wants to live. If you are a child of God, He is pushing and trying and prying and convicting to try to get you to live a life that honors Him, to lift Him up, so that you may be able to battle strongly, confidently, successfully against old Satan. Because he ain't giving up. He's studying you. He's watching film on you. Let me see how they handled this yesterday. Let me see what they look at when they click on the internet. Be careful. We need to work out. We need to be strong. So too many say they've given their life over to God, or given their heart over to God, but they haven't given their life. That's the thing. They haven't let God take over all areas of their life. And y'all have heard me say many times, church attendance or not, when there's been no change, then there's been no change. Very, very simple. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 through 9. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 through 9. Something I want you to be thinking about as you listen or read along with these scriptures. What gets the majority of your focus? What are we teaching our kids is a priority for any of us. Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 through 9. But what things were gained to me? See, Paul lived a life of luxury for a long time. All he could ever want. He said, but what things were gained to me? Those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, worthless, that I may win Christ and be found in Him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law. That was a big statement to make back then. But that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God, by our faith. By our faith. He tells us what we are to do. He tells us where we're to go. He gives us many, many instructions. After Paul considered everything he had accomplished in his life, he said it was all worthless when compared to knowing Christ. This is a profound statement. This is a profound statement about values. A person's personal relationship with Christ is more important than anything else. To know Christ should be our ultimate goal. Consider your values. Do you place anything above your relationship with Christ? If your priorities are wrong, you need to reorder them. You need to reorder them. Let's look at some Christ-like characteristic traits in Galatians. Back up just a couple of books there. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 through 26. And we see, and I want to point out, we see the fruit of the Spirit. Most people unknowingly, unawarely, say the fruits of the Spirit. The Word of God says the fruit of the Spirit. So when you get saved, it's all planted. It is all planted. And then if we don't grow, we are going to lack in one or many of these areas. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 through 26 says, but the fruit of the Spirit is, this is what you should measure your life, not by the world's standards, not by how many trophies or how many medallions or how much money or how big a truck or how nice a house. You should look and compare your success. How much of this is seen in my life? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering or patience, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance, or self-control. Against such, there's no law. This all comes from Jesus Christ. They that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust or passionately. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vain glory, provoking one another, envying one another. So Paul's reminding, God's reminding through Paul, the church in Galatia here, he says, if you are born again of Jesus Christ, if you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, this is the fruit that you should have in your life. And as you grow, if you mature, and if you teach your children, you're going to show them that love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance are what's important. People are going to see that. Your children are going to see that. Those are Christ-like characteristics. Fruit is not plural there. That is all in one. You get it when you get Jesus Christ. So taken together, they're the fruit of the Spirit, meaning they were with the Spirit of God planted into you. All of these attributes are present to some degree according to how you embrace them and allow the Lord to grow and to show that through you. So what do you do with your fruit? What do you do with your fruit? Do you purposely not water some of those areas? Do you purposefully put a little extra water in some of those areas? We can't just hang fruit and claim it to be real. That graft will fail every time. You can't make it being or trying to be self-dependent. Jesus is saying to you, if you'll dig your roots down deep in me, I'll produce the fruit. Just get to know me and learn who you are in me. Jesus is bigger than your past. He is stronger than your weakness. He can reach far beyond where you have fallen or have ran to. You need to quit trying to stay safe and act like you are. And if you are here and you have not had a personal relationship, you have a perfect opportunity to do so. Christ has us in his arms. He is all in us. Let's dig into him and then just go do life in that personal relationship with him. There is no growth in Christ outside of Christ. There is no growth in Christ outside of Christ. If you want to get to know the Lord, see, the Bible says, and I've said it many times, right? The Bible says the Word became flesh. So that tells me that if I want to get to know the person Jesus Christ better, I need to get to know his Word. How am I going to get to know his Word? By studying his Word. By reading his Word. By meditating on his Word. The fruit of the Spirit is just that. All of that is going to grow. It's not the fruit of Mark. It's not the fruit of me. It's not the fruit of you. We need to look and compare what we do to Jesus Christ. Where do you spend your time? Is it with him or is it otherwise? You can rest easy. Our job is simply to know him, to be fed by him, to be refreshed by him, to rest in him, and to love him, and you will thrive in him. We had shirts made some years back. We were still in the old church. And it actually came from an old Bible study. To know, to own, and to known. To make known. See, we had three shapes. One pointed inwardly. One pointed up to us. And one points outwardly. See, we need to have that personal relationship. We need to allow him to come into every part of our life. So we need to know him. We need to own our faith. And we need to make it known. We need to make it known. We're going to close there. And I want to ask you one question. Do you know your faith? Do you know your faith and what that means to you? Please stand. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, at the close of our service, offering a time of response, Lord, for each and every one of us. Lord, I pray, I hope, my desire is that each and every one of us that have heard this message, that get to hear this message, that we are convicted by your Holy Spirit, Lord, and we don't cover it up, but we embrace it, Lord. Maybe we've realized that all we've done is play church, maybe our entire life. I pray that each one of us realize that being raised in church is not salvation without a personal relationship with you. Convict our hearts, Lord. Burden us that we may know ourselves. Where's our faith, Lord? Show us where it's at, what it's in. What are we showing those around us? What are we teaching them? What we need to first be the best at, Lord. Lord, we thank you for your love, your mercy, your grace. Lord, and the greatest sacrifice, the greatest gift ever, ever given, Lord. Your precious darling Son, Jesus Christ, came, was born. Lord, it's the time that we celebrate, Lord, this year, this time of year, Lord. May we realize the true meaning. We thank you and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. For on your corpses all night. Divine, oh night, when Christ was born. Gospel is peace. Chains he shall break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy in grace. Chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh, praise his name forever. His power and glory evermore proclaim. His power and glory. Divine.